Well, good morning, Cornerstone. Will you please stand and worship with us? Continue to worship with us and sing about God's promises. Just what you say.
For the storms may come and the winds may blow, I'll remain steadfast. And let my heart learn when you speak a word, it will come to pass. Is your faithfulness to me? Is your faithfulness to me? From the rising sun to the setting sun, I will praise your name. Is your faithfulness to me? God from age to age, though the earth may pass away, your word remains the same. Your history can prove there's nothing you can't do. You're faithful and true. Though the storms may come and the winds may blow, I'll remain steadfast. And let my heart learn when you speak a word, it will come to pass. Great is your faithfulness to to the setting, same, I will praise your name. Great is your faithfulness to me.
I put my faith in Jesus, my anchor to the ground, my hope and firm foundation. He'll never let me down. I put my faith in Jesus, my anchor to the ground, my hope and firm foundation. He'll never let me down. I put my faith in Jesus, my anchor to the ground, my hope and firm foundation.
Silence steals my voice. You understand me. You understand me. Come to me in the valley of unknowns. You understand me. You understand me. You understand me, God. You understand me. So I throw all my cares before you. My doubts and fears don't scare you. You're bigger than I thought you were. You're bigger than I thought. So I stop all negotiations with the God of all creation. You're bigger than I thought you were. You're bigger than I thought you were. I believe, but help my unbelief. You understand me. You understand me. Help me reach the faith that's underneath. You understand me. You understand me. You understand me, God. You understand me. So I throw all my cares before you. My doubts and fears don't scare you. You're bigger than I thought you were. You're bigger than I thought. So I stop all negotiations with the God of all creation. You're bigger than I thought you were. You're bigger than I thought you were. So I stop all negotiations with the God of all creation. You're bigger than I thought you were. You're God, we sing to you this morning. We sing you're bigger than we thought, God. And every time that we sing this song, God, may you be revealed more and more to how great you are, how big you are in comparison to any of us, in comparison to anything, and in comparison to all of creation, you are so much bigger. God, may we cast our problems, our negotiations, God, any fears that we have, may we give them to you. Because although we're too small to handle them, you're not even close. It's in your name that we pray. Amen. Well, will you please turn to those around you and greet them and wish them a happy almost spring. Well, good morning. We are so happy and glad that you are here. I feel like Pastor Bob right now with this in front of me. I don't like this. We have just a few announcements. First being, if you're new here, first off, welcome. We're very glad that you're here. We would love to connect with you. So there's a connect card in the seat in front of you. It's simple. It's not hard to fill out. We're not going to stalk you. Don't worry. But we would love to get to know you more and to get you plugged in here. There's a lot of ministries that we're looking for people to get involved in. And if you're looking to get involved, we would love to have you. So, or if you have any prayer requests, please fill one of these out. The next thing that we have is a thing that we've been doing for the past week. We've been announcing it for a couple. It's that cross back there, and it's emphasizing God's promises to his people. So if you have a burden, if you have a emotion, if you have a fear that you're feeling, we ask you to just put it on the cross. It doesn't have to be anything elaborate. You don't have to write your life story out. You don't have to write 10 pages of why God needs to get you through this. Simply a word or a sentence or something to just put on the cross as a symbol that, God, I'm giving this over to you, is why we have that back there. And there are verses that we will give to you to help you through this time. If you saw, there's post-it notes either on the seat in front of you or somewhere close to you. Those are what you put on the cross. So you can fill that out during the sermon, right now during, if I'm talking, or whenever you feel it, when you're leaving, you can put those up there. I think that's it for announcements. So if you'll pray for me for the offering. Pray with me, not for me. Dear God, we come to you today, Lord, and we are so thankful, God, that we are allowed to meet in this space. Lord, it's been a weird year for everyone, and we're almost hitting that exact mark. But God, we're very glad that we can be in this space. So God, I pray that we can continue to, that the offering that is brought today, Lord, continues the ministries that you've blessed us with and that we're blessing you with. God, so Lord, may we give with out of love and out of thankfulness for you. And may this church continue to do your work. It's in your name that we pray. Amen.
morning, everyone. I am Pastor Bob, and I don't feel weird up here. Glad to be here. Glad to see all of you. It is the mark, just about the mark when we, a year ago, when this pandemic hit us and everything did go a little weird, and this church has done a wonderful job, I think, of managing, you know, how we do church during all of that, and we're outside, and what an effort that was this summer. I know some of these guys, I don't know if you know that, but they were here at 5:30 in the morning for the whole summer, and they just did a fabulous job with that. I mean, just unbelievable. And yeah, and back there too, those guys setting up. And we have built in a live stream here, the quality of which is just way up there. And our group that watches our live stream has continued to increase the whole year. And we have probably around 300 or so playthroughs every single week of our services. So we've got a bigger congregation watching online than we have on Sunday morning. I've noticed that the migration here has gone to the second service. I don't know if the sleep-in thing is what's going on or what, but glad to have you guys here. The board met yesterday to kind of consider, you know, where we are at and if there's anything further we should be doing as a church to manage things. And we've decided to continue the social distancing, continue the sanitizing of hand encouragement. And a little step away is we're not going to do the temperature taking anymore. Guess what? In all the whole year, we never had one person with a temperature. So we're going to stop taking temperatures for you, and we're also going to make mask wearing a voluntary thing for you. It always has been kind of voluntary, but we haven't given out one ticket to anybody that's come here and not worn a mask, but we're just going to open that up a little bit and say it's up to you if you want to wear a mask, okay? So step by step, here we go. We're doing our best. I just hope that we can all kind of work together and not get too wild about these things and divide ourselves over them. We've done a great job thus far. We are in a series on the power of the gospel. Today we're going to talk about how God can change anyone. I have watched 4 babies come into this world. Almost missed one. Literally was running to get to the delivery room and walked in, and the doctor just went hut hut, and that was the end of that. That was a fast one. But I got to tell you, I have seen it 4 times, and each time I've seen it, it's always been the same experience. It's been like this overwhelmingly powerful, if I hadn't seen it, I wouldn't believe it kind of an experience. It's like, my goodness, unbelievable, right? And I know that if I get any further into that experience in detail, I'll be sleeping on the couch. So I won't get any further into detail. But that's a wild and fantastic experience to see somebody born. And Jesus says in the story we're going to look at today, you must be born again. And when you are, then you will experience an even more powerful birth than the birth that happened the first time. So we're going to look at this conversation that Jesus has with a guy named Nicodemus, and it's a conversation. So we're going to do the whole conversation. So hang on. It's not, you know, just like reading half a book or watching half a movie. You can't talk about half a conversation and walk away feeling like you've gotten it all. So we're going to do the whole conversation. So we're going to look at John chapter 3, where the story is, and begin that conversation between Jesus and Nicodemus. Now there was a Pharisee, a man named Nicodemus, who was a member of the Jewish ruling council. He came to Jesus at night and said, "Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God. For no one could perform the signs you are doing if God were not with him." Jesus replied, "Very truly I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God unless they are born again." "How can someone be born when they are old?" Nicodemus asked. "Surely they cannot enter a second time into their mother's womb and be born." Jesus answered, Very truly I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God unless they are born of water and spirit. Flesh gives birth to flesh, but spirit gives birth to spirit. You should not be surprised at my saying you must be born again. The wind blows wherever it pleases. You hear its sound, but you cannot tell where it comes from or where it is going. So it is with everyone born of the Spirit. How can this be? Nicodemus asked. You are Israel's teacher, said Jesus, and do not understand these things? So we're introduced to this man named Nicodemus, who is a Pharisee. And that means he is part of the right wing. He's on the conservative side in first century Judaism, but he is very respected in the Jewish community for his good deeds, his commitment to orthodoxy, although they tended to be a little excessive in rule keeping. On top of his religious affiliation, it says that he's a member of the Jewish Council of 71, or the Sanhedrin, who ruled the country under the Roman government. So he belongs to a specific religious party. He's also part of the political elite. And this combination really put him at the top of the heap in the country. In fact, Jesus calls him Israel's teacher. And that expression suggests that he was widely regarded as a distinguished professor of divinity of the Old Testament. So he is politically, religiously connected. He is a learned person. He's professorial. Verse 3 says that he comes to Jesus at night. Some of you know about Nick at night. You ever hear that on Nickelodeon? That's where that comes from. Nick at night. Not really. Just made that up. My jokes are always pretty bad, but why does Nicodemus show up at night? Why does he come at night? Now, many believe it is because it would have been embarrassing or humiliating or below him to be seen with Jesus, so he sneaks off at night and meets him, you know, in some quiet place at night where he can't be seen. And I think that would be an easy explanation, except that Nicodemus shows up a couple of other times in this book, and both times he's not that guy. He actually doesn't care what people think. He's willing to speak out. He's kind of an independent-minded dude. So I don't believe that he comes at night. He might have, because he's humiliated or embarrassed or feels like Jesus is below him. He's just a prophet, you know, just a teacher from Galilee. I don't think that's why he comes at night. If you read the Gospel of John, you will note that John plays around with light and darkness. Later on, for example, when Jesus is betrayed, he dismisses Judas, the man who betrays him. And as Judas goes out the door, John comments, and it was night. In John 13:30, it's as if John is saying, here's this guy that is leaving Jesus and is really lost in the darkness of his life. So I don't believe he comes at night because he's embarrassed about being seen with Jesus. This is what I do know. I do know that you can be really smart, and you can be really connected, and you can be even wealthy. We think that he was also wealthy. You can be respected by everybody. You can go to church. You can be very biblically knowledgeable and still be a really lost soul. I've had many people in my years as a pastor come to me who are very lost and living in very dark places in their lives spiritually, and some leave that way, and others are found by Christ, and I know that that's some of you. And some of you I look at, and I've actually been in the presence of you when God brought you to himself. And you're found by Christ, and you literally come out of the darkness that is your life and are made alive in Christ. I want you to see this Nicodemus for all he is and all he people consider him to be. I always picture them standing on a street corner in Jerusalem at night, having a conversation, or maybe sitting in a cafe in the corner table. He is a lost soul. But he comes to Jesus. Let's read on, verse 2b. He says, Rabbi, which is respectful, by the way. That's a respectful way to address Jesus. We know that you are a teacher who has come from God. For no one could perform the signs you are doing if God were not with him. It's just a little thing. Leave it up there for a second, Misty. Can you go back? Check it out. Rabbi, we. Who's we? We know that you are a teacher who comes from God. It's just a little thing, but I want you to notice that Nicodemus is by himself, yet he says we as he talks to Jesus. Now, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God. We means more than just me. Who's the we? It means that he is one among others who Nicodemus knows are in the same boat that he's in. It's the we. He is among other lost souls. The difference is he's interested in Jesus. And there are a lot of people who are lost souls. Some of them are interested in Jesus, some of them are not. I'd like to give some credit to Nicodemus for stepping out, making an effort to connect with Jesus, even if he has to do it all by himself. Do you think Nicodemus was at all nervous to come alone to talk to Jesus about spiritual things? I do. We are a church and have always been a church that welcomes Nicodemuses. It's part of who we are. And by the way, you know, I see you out there, and I'm grateful that you are here. I also see you run out of church before I can get to you. I see you when you get up the nerve to say hi to me. I know you're nervous and wondering if I'm going to ask you some awkward question or put you on the spot. Maybe a question out of the blue, like, do you like beer? Might surprise you, but I used to work in underground construction. I want to tell you, there's no rougher bunch than guys who work underground in construction. I know all there is to know about drinking beer and other stuff too. I've always considered that history as one of my greatest assets as a pastor. So you should know that nothing you could possibly tell me about yourself would surprise me. I'll never forget an operator that we had on our crew. We called him Shorty. We called him that because he lost half of one of his arms. But he could still operate his crane with just the stump, like nobody's business. He would operate it like this. Kids used to come up and check out while we were digging holes, and Shorty would stick his stump in his mouth, and it would look like his whole arm was down his throat, and he'd just laugh and get a kick out of that. But Shorty was one lost soul. He would usually leave at the end of the day and go to the bar, and he would drink more than any person should ever drink, and then he'd come back to the job site. He didn't go home. He would lay in the grass next to the crane and sleep. In the morning, I used to bring him a cup of coffee and wake him up, and he'd have all weeds in his hair, and he'd work all day long. That's not Nicodemus. That's a different lost soul. Nicodemus is actually the opposite. He's a super clean-cut, super religious, super esteemed individual. But he is really, really lost. And he lets Jesus know that he is a we. Something Jesus already knows. Thank you for the we's who have the guts to come to Jesus with their questions. Jesus responds to Nicodemus, verse 3. Very truly I tell you. Now he says that twice, very truly. He's saying, I'm telling you the truth now. I want you to really understand it. Look me in the eye. Very truly I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God unless they are born again. Now Nicodemus is impressed, he tells Jesus, by his miracles. He thinks they're from God. He wants to learn what Jesus is all about. And Jesus takes it to the next level and introduces the topic of the miracle of completely changing somebody's life. Jesus says, nobody can see the kingdom of God, the place where everything is made new, right? Nobody can see that unless they themselves are made new. They must be born again to see the kingdom of God. Now Nicodemus goes with it, but replies with a bit of a sneer. He's a smart guy. He's engaged. He says, how can anyone be born when they are old? Surely they cannot enter a second time into their mother's womb and be born. Now I want you to understand that Nicodemus hasn't missed one thing. He is one smart dude. He gets the metaphor. He is now pressing Jesus to go further. He doesn't really believe Jesus is saying that you have to crawl back into your mother's womb and be born again. What he's doing is questioning if Jesus is over-promising. Aren't some people beyond changing? I mean, this is coming from a legalistic, religious dude. Aren't some people, Jesus, beyond changing? Aren't there people who are so lost, whose lives are so morally dark, that they are unchangeable? You think he was a little tired of trying to get to people to be good and them not being good? Aren't there people so lost and so morally dark that they're unchangeable? Nicodemus knows people like that. He deals with them all day long. He's questioning if even God has the power to change some people. Do you know anybody in that category? Someone you believe that maybe even a miracle from God would not be able to change them. If you know someone, say their name in your mind. How many of you have named someone in your mind? The 19th century poet Alfred Lord Tennyson wrote, ah, for a man to arise in me that the man I am may no longer be. Jesus is saying to Nicodemus, as smart and religious and important as you think you are really dumb if you think God doesn't have the power to change anyone, no matter how lost, no matter how dark they may be. The kingdom of God is full of people that other people thought could never be changed. Look at the entire ministry of Jesus and who he reached. Many Christians are set back on their heels right now by the spiritual and moral decline that is occurring in our country. Most recently, we've heard the news of the Equality Act, an act that supports a very dark and immoral ideology and the view of human sexuality, and it's moving swiftly towards becoming the law of our land. Are the people who support that ideology, think of them in your mind, who are they? Are they beyond God's power to change? Absolutely not. Nobody is out of reach. The kingdom of heaven is filled with people that nobody believed could be changed until God changed them. There is incredible regenerating power in the gospel for everyone who believes. That's why Paul says, I'm not ashamed of it. It's the power of God unto salvation to everyone who believes. There's a righteousness from God that's revealed in it, a righteousness that is by faith from the beginning to the end. Nobody is out of God's reach. So Jesus goes on to clarify what it means to be born again. He anticipates the next question that would come up in Nicodemus's mind. Verse 5, very truly, look at me, Nicodemus, look at me. Very truly, I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God without being born of water and the Spirit. Now, some people think Jesus is talking now about two births, not just one. Water is natural birth and Spirit is supernatural birth. It could mean that, but again, I don't think so. Jesus is pursuing Nicodemus. He knows Nicodemus is a professor of Old Testament. He's reminding the professor of a prophecy in Ezekiel 36 where water and Spirit are linked. Isaiah 36, 25, I will sprinkle clean water on you and you will be clean, indicating moral cleansing. Verse 27, and I will put my Spirit in you, indicating life from God. He is describing what God promises to produce, to change people. Jesus is reminding Nicodemus to believe what the Scriptures teach about who God is and what God can do. He's reminding the professor. Do you need to be reminded who God is and what God can do in this world? When the darkness comes, when people rise up that you think can't be changed. It is not about what you think is possible. Change is not dependent on our changing people who need to be changed. The minds and hearts of our kids or our politicians or our neighbors or our spouses. It is dependent on what God can do. Let me remind you. Jesus says, what's in the Bible? Who's in charge? Who's all-powerful? Who's the sovereign Lord of heaven and earth? Jesus explains a little further, verses 6 and 7. Flesh gives birth to flesh, but the Spirit gives birth to spirit. You should not be surprised, Nicodemus, at my saying you must be born again. Why are you surprised, Professor? Jesus is driving home his point. Professor Nicodemus, pigs give birth to pigs. Cockroaches give birth to cockroaches. Bats to bats. Flesh produces flesh. Why are you surprised that the Spirit produces rebirth? It's what God does. It's what He's always done. He makes people new. Why would that surprise you? Nicodemus, I think, just takes it in at this point. God, the Holy Spirit, can change anyone. He believes that. But do you believe it right now, Nicodemus? Do you believe it today? Jesus adds another layer. Verse 8, the wind, it blows wherever it pleases. You hear its sound, but you cannot tell where it comes from or where it is going. Maybe Jesus and Nicodemus are standing on that street corner now, and the sycamore branch is swaying in the evening breeze. And Jesus says, you don't need to know where the wind comes from to believe in the wind. They didn't know what we know about meteorology today. In those days, nobody could explain or forecast the movement of the wind. Jesus' point, you don't need to know how exactly and when exactly God will move to change somebody. You ever worry about that? When is God going to move to change somebody? Today, I need it now. Change this person. Jesus says, no, your role is to hear and experience the movement, but not try to forecast or control it. What? Verse 8b, so it is, Jesus says, with everyone born of the Spirit. This is how they think about things. Every born-again believer knows that God is in control and appreciates that they are not. Some things about God we can feel and appreciate, but find very difficult to forecast or control. In the 18th century, there was a Billy Graham-like evangelist by the name of George Whitefield. He preached the gospel to tens of thousands of people, and he preached again and again and again from this passage. It was his favorite passage for preaching to thousands. He kept saying, you must be born again. You must be born again. And finally, somebody who'd heard him preach it so many times got irritated and met him and cornered him and asked him, Mr. Whitefield, why is it that you keep preaching again and again? You must be born again. You must be born again. Because, sir, Whitefield replied, you must be born again. Here's God's word to you. Just because you can't forecast it or control how it happens, how your son or your daughter or your friend or your parent or somebody in a position of authority or someone you know who's really lost and living in darkness is going to be changed by God spiritually and morally. That doesn't mean God doesn't know exactly how and exactly when. Obviously, we know that God uses the hearing of the gospel. And God deploys the Holy Spirit and His church. And God orders circumstances that bring people to faith in Jesus Christ. But how exactly God will do it for the person you have in mind? It's likely you don't have a clue. But that doesn't mean God can't do it because He can. He's not limited by what we know. God is like the wind, Nicodemus. He moves in ways we can't forecast or control. Nicodemus already knows this. He just needs to believe what he believes. Jesus continues. John 3:11. Very truly I tell you, there it is again, listen to me now. We speak of what we know and we testify to what we have seen, but still you people do not accept our testimony. I have spoken to you of earthly things and you do not believe. How then will you believe if I speak of heavenly things? No man, no one has ever gone into heaven except the one who came from heaven, the Son of Man. Notice how Jesus picks up the same a tactic as Nicodemus and uses the first person plural we. But he sets it up a little differently. We speak of what we know and we testify to what we have seen, but still you do not accept our testimony. Jesus is telling Nicodemus that we are among the believers, but you are among the unbelievers. Can you imagine this guy who is the believer of the believers, the leader, being told that he's among the unbelievers? It must have just shocked him to hear that. There are actually believers and unbelievers according to Jesus. You are either one or the other. It's how the world of people is divided by God. I'm sure Nicodemus was shocked that his name would be mentioned among the unbelievers. Shocked. Would you be shocked if Jesus told you that your name was mentioned among the unbelievers, that you were among them? Matthew records Jesus talking about how many people at the end of time, at the final judgment, at the final resurrection, will be shocked to learn that their name is numbered among the unbelievers. In fact, Jesus said, I just separated them, goats and sheep. And many of the goats said, what do you mean you don't know me? And Jesus said, I never knew you. If you want to know if you're numbered among one group or the other, wouldn't you want to know how to get out of that group and into this group? Wouldn't you want to know the truth about how to be saved? A lot of us are trying to figure out who's telling us the truth about how to be saved from the coronavirus. Who's the expert? Who is telling us the truth? Dr. Fauci? The radical left? The radical right? MSNBC? Fox? I don't know. It's very confusing. Very truly I say to you, Jesus said, Nicodemus, you're not among the saved. Very truly I say to you, this is not Fox News now or MSNBC. Very truly I say to you, you are not among the saved. You're among the unsaved. Jesus is claiming for himself the final word on the subject. Now what makes him such an expert? That last phrase, no one has ever gone into heaven except the one who came from heaven, the Son of Man, is what makes Jesus the consummate expert. And don't think that Nicodemus, the professor, has missed the designation here. Jesus is letting Nicodemus know, who is standing about 2 feet from him or sitting across the table from him, that he is the Son of Man, the one mentioned in Daniel 7, who's been promised by God to come into this earth from heaven with all the power and all the glory of God to save people. The Son of Man is a consummate expert on how to be saved. Nicodemus is 2 feet from him, has seen all kinds of things that he has done, and yet he is among the unbelievers. I can't tell you how many times I went to church. I was part of a family that you went to church. And I went to church from the time I can remember at 9:30 in the morning. Then I went to Sunday school. And then I went to church at 7 o'clock at night. But then when they stopped being such a rural church and they didn't have to milk the cows, we switched it to 5:30 at night. And then I went to youth group. And then I went to Wednesday night catechism. And then I went to everything else that my parents said I had to go to. I saw people come to Christ. I saw many Christian examples. I heard thousands of sermons. I sat in all the Sunday school classes. I filled in all the blanks of the catechism of the Reformed theology. I learned all of these things, and yet I was unsaved. Now, how in the world is that possible? And yet, the testimony was right in front of me the whole time. I can remember faces of people who taught me Sunday school, who told me the truth about Jesus Christ. So many times. Jesus is sitting across or standing next to Nicodemus. He's a learned guy. He knows it all. D.A. Carson writes, at the end of the day, to understand Christianity, sooner or later you must come to grips with Christianity's revelation claims. What do you do with Jesus, who claims to come from God, to be one with God? Who gives you information about things that you cannot otherwise have information about? No one has made a trip there, taken notes, come back, and filed a report. This is either true or it is the most unmitigated garbage, blasphemous silliness. But there is not a way that you can walk away from this thinking, well, Jesus is just a nice moralizing teacher. The reason why Jesus could speak about being born again with the authority and confidence he displayed is bound up in his identity. To dismiss what he says is to deny who he is. So Jesus now tells Nicodemus how to be saved, to be born again. John 3:14. Jesus, just as Moses lifted up the snake in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that everyone who believes may have eternal life in him. The story Jesus refers to about the snake being lifted up in the wilderness is a story that Nicodemus, again, would know from the book of Numbers. It is a really weird story that happened during the journey from Egypt to the promised land. Jesus uses it to get his message across to Nicodemus about how to be saved. Numbers 21:4, they travel from Mount Hor along the route to the Red Sea to go around Edom, but the people grew impatient on the way. They spoke against God and against Moses and said, why have you brought us up out of Egypt to die in the wilderness? There is no bread, there is no water, and we detest this miserable food. Then the Lord sent venomous snakes among them. They bit the people, and many Israelites died. The people came to Moses and said, we sinned when we spoke against the Lord and against you. Pray that the Lord will take the snakes away from us. So Moses prayed for the people. The Lord said to Moses, make a snake and put it up on a pole. Anyone who is bitten can look at it and live. So Moses made a bronze snake and put it up on a pole. Then when anyone was bitten by the snake and looked at the bronze snake, they lived. And Jesus says, just as to Nicodemus, just as Moses lifted up the snake in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that everyone who believes may have eternal life in him. Nicodemus. I don't think Nicodemus is missing the point at all now. I think Jesus has brought him right to the foot of the cross. Jesus is like the snake on the pole. He is the Son of Man. He's the Savior of people who've been bitten by sin, by the snake, and are going to die. Nicodemus has been bitten and is going to die. You've been bitten, Nicodemus. We've all been bitten. I've been bitten. You've been bitten. What do we need to do to be saved? We all need to look at Jesus on the cross, dying for our sins, to save us, to give us eternal life. Look to Jesus for your salvation, Nicodemus. Do you think that Nicodemus is looking at him right now? It's not often that we read John 3:16 and following in the context of Jesus' conversation with Nicodemus. But he is the person that Jesus originally said it to. He said it to the guy who came out of the darkness to meet with Jesus. I want you to see this proud Pharisee, a member of the Sanhedrin, a Bible professor, kissed his wife and said, I'm going somewhere. Maybe didn't tell her where he's going, but I'll be back in a little while. Made an appointment somehow with Jesus alone at night. He wants to know who Jesus is. He sees the power of God at work in him that he can't deny. He's wanting answers about life that only God can give. Maybe that is you too. And Jesus ends the conversation with these words to Nicodemus. John 3:16 through 21. It makes me emotional to think about it. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe stands condemned already because they have not believed in the name of God's one and only Son. This is the verdict. Light has come into the world, but people love darkness instead of light because of their deeds. They were evil. Everyone who does evil hates the light and will not come to the light for fear that their deeds will be exposed. But whoever lives by the truth comes into the light so that it may be seen plainly that what they have done has been done in the sight of God. We're not told whether Nicodemus believed in Jesus and became a Christian that night. I can't believe it. Why wouldn't you finish the story? But later we're told that he speaks up in the Sanhedrin in defense of Jesus. He tries to keep them from acting without a trial. And later he accompanies Joseph of Arimathea in retrieving Jesus' body from the cross. And he helps him to place it in his tomb. I personally believe Nicodemus believed in Jesus that night and was born again. And I think we'll see him in God's eternal kingdom when we go there someday. Why don't you look him up? What an interesting guy to meet. I have watched 4 babies come into this world. And even though I saw it 4 times, every time it was an overwhelmingly powerful experience. Every time someone accepts Jesus Christ as their Savior and Lord, God says it's even more powerful than being born the first time. For that to happen, Jesus says, you must be born again. The good news is, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. Mr. Whitfield, why is it that you keep preaching again and again that you must be born again? You must be born again. Because, dear sir, you must be born again. Let's pray. Lord, we bow before you and your wonderful gospel, the power of God in our life to save us. I pray that this power will be at work in us, the resurrection power, to encourage us, not in just knowing that we're saved for eternity, but in this life, to know that the power of God is at work and that we have confidence in you that goes way beyond ourselves. Thank you for such hope that we know in Christ. In his name we pray. Amen.
Will you please stand and sing for this last song?
You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you. Worship you. You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. You are. is keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are here, oh, touching every heart. I worship you, I worship you. You are here, healing every heart. I worship you, I worship you. You are here, turning lives around. I worship you, I worship you. You are here, mending every heart. I worship you, I worship you. Promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. 'Cause you are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
That is who you are. That is who you are. That is who you are. That is who you are. That is who you are. That is who you are. That is who you are. That is who you are. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop. You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. 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 That is who you are.
You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God. That is who you are.
And now go in peace. And may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God the Father and the fellowship and communion of his Holy Spirit be and abide with all of you. Amen. Have a great week.